Good morning again, everyone. This is Philip Griffiths, and the second talk of the morning is going to be by Radu Laza on moduli geometry versus Hodge theory. Radu?
Okay, thank you, Philip. It would be nice to be in Miami now, and maybe we'll have another conference in better times. But okay, So as it turns out, I'm at the beginning of the conference, and several of my collaborators will talk in the conference. So I think I will set up the table for them, and hopefully there will be some coherence to the talks. I mean, we didn't quite coordinate. Anyway, so the setup is that we consider a moduli space. Typically, by this, I'm considering smooth varieties. Later, when we talk about surfaces, the moduli space will include the ADE singularity surfaces with canonical singularities as well, but that will come later. And we assume, given a good period map, meaning that typically we assume Torelli holds some version of Torelli. And the purpose of the talk is to consider compactification. So ideally, we would like to have a compactification here, some sort of compactification there. And the main topic of the talk will be to compare the two compactifications. Of course, I mean, life is more complicated. And I mean, so you'll see that basically, two out of the three are issues. So sometimes we have compactification on the geometric side, sometimes we have on the Hodge theoretic side, and the comparison is always tricky. Okay, why do we care about this one? So our perspective is that D-mod gamma and these compactifications are pretty nice. They carry a lot of information, and you extract information about the moduli space. So like a simple application, for instance, is this classification of automorphisms for K3s or cubic fourfold, something that I've been doing recently, and many others. Here today, and I mean, a lot of the conference will be centered around the structure of the KSBA compactification for H and I surfaces. So what is H and I surfaces? So those are surfaces of general type with small invariants, specifically PG equals 2, regular surface, and the K square, either 1 for I surfaces or 2 for H surfaces. And I think the terminology is due to Philip. H stands for Horikawa, and in our world we learn about the I surfaces later, but they turn out to be easier. So I stands slightly easier than H. This is a long-term project with Mark Green, Philip Griffiths, and Colleen Robles, and I'll refer generically. I mean, one paper is on the archive, several others are in various states, so I'll refer generically to this as GGLR. There is a bit of collaboration, or at least conversations with Marco Franciosi, Rita Pardini, and Sonkier Orlenski. They will all talk, I think, later in the week. And they approach the subject from a different perspective, and we kind of meet in the middle. So that's the philosophy. Okay, so why do we care about this specific class of surfaces? Because from our perspective, Hodge theoretically, they are the simplest non-classical cases of period map. I mean, this is a bit arguable, but let me explain what I mean by this. So a variation of Hodge structures basically satisfies Griffiths transversality, and this can be trivial, and this is a good case. Okay, so this is a case that we are happy, or non-trivial kind of ends. The trivial case, basically, geometrically, there are only two two situations that occur naturally. There are a couple of other kind of derived situations that occur, but naturally there are either abelian varieties, weight one Hodge structures, or weight two with PG equals one. So these are the K3 type. And we can say a lot in this kind of trivial case. So and our goal, and I mean the period maps were used intensively in this trivial from the perspective of Griffith's transversality. So the period map is kind of the main tool for abelian varieties, K3s, and so on. So what we really want, and I mean kind of what we are trying to do, is to extend this theory to the non-trivial case. So what is special about the trivial case? I mean, automatically in the trivial case, the period domain becomes a Hermitian symmetric domain, and the group gamma is arithmetic, and one has this Bailey-Borel theory, which says that, so Bailey-Borel gives you, basically says that this is quasi-projective, the period space is quasi-projective, and it has a natural projective compactification, which is obtained as the ring of automorphic forms. So what is good about this one is natural, meaning no choices are involved here. So it comes, I would call it canonical, but I mean, this has a different meaning typically, and is minimal in the sense that it satisfies this Borel extension theorem. So basically any time I have a normal crossing compactification, then that normal crossing compactification dominates the Bailey-Borel compactification. But again, this is the classical case. I mean, the bad about the Bailey-Borel compactification is that it's small. I mean, one should think about the Bailey-Borel compactification as like almost like a point compactification. It's really small, and some examples will come up later. And when you have like a small compactification, is singular. Here, one should say that actually the Bailey-Borel compactification is not really bad. Is low canonical from the perspective, is a low canonical compactification from the perspective of birational geometry, and one can do some geometry on it, kind of some modification on it and stuff like that. I will not say much about that today. Okay, and this kind of tying in with what Dan was talking about, there is this work of Mumford and Kempf and Knudsen and all of those people in the 70s. They produce a toroidal resolution, which is very nice, but of course depends on the choice sigma, and this is an issue. In fact, even more subtle, it turns out that geometrically, the toroidal compactification is not always the right one. And in fact, at least when talking about K3s, there is this semitoric compactification of Luyhenga that interpolates between the Bailey-Borel and toroidal. So the toroidal depends on a choice of a rational polyhedral decomposition of a certain cone, which is round. And I mean, this is kind of the difficulty. The cone is round. You have rational polyhedral. You will have infinitely many kind of these things. It has to be finite with respect to the when you consider the group gamma and so on. What Luyhenga said is that you actually can do a similar picture, but assuming only locally rational polyhedral. So if I'm intersecting with a polyhedron, I'm getting a rational polyhedral decomposition. And one, in particular, for instance, you see that you recover the Bailey-Borel compactification just taking no decomposition. So the round cone is locally rational polyhedral, kind of trivial. In terms of Hodge structure, this encodes the graded pieces of the Hodge structure, pieces of Hodge, of the limit mix Hodge structure, and this one sometimes encodes the full limit mix Hodge structure. And I think you'll hear the talk of Colleen a lot about this. Okay, and basically, I mean, our secret—I mean, not so secret—goal is to obtain a similar picture in the non-classical case. And this is only conjectural. There are a bunch of partial results. So let me say here what one expects. First of all, this is only this. Just to warn you, this is only a relative compactification. I mean, the best one can hope is a relative compactification, meaning that if I have a moduli space here is called B, the basis of a variation of Hodge structure, I'm taking Z to the B, the image of the period map. And then I'm assuming this is given. So I'm assuming given a normal crossing compactification, then the content of the statement is that there exists this part here. There exists a projective compactification together with a Borel-style extension. And furthermore, we expect that the boundary of this compactification is parameterizes the graded pieces of the limit mix Hodge structure. And I mean, okay, we have some partial results, and also from a different perspective, from this whole minimality perspective, there is a lot of work recently kind of around this type of conjecture. So Ben Becker, Brunebarbe and Zimmermann, and some of it also with Bruno Klinger, what they show is, first of all, kind of Z, the image of the period map, is quasi-projective. And then maybe, if I'm reading correctly, the more recent papers of them, they can even say that the pieces of the boundary are quasi-projective. So we are claiming that what we get is projective, and we get this one by gluing the various pieces associated to the limit mix Hodge structure. And what is known, at least, is that each piece itself is quasi-projective. I mean, and basically what remains here, the big open question, is that we can glue all these pieces and to get the projectivity and get everything, one only needs to show that what you get is a complex analytic space. So the gluing, I think we have some sort of gluing. We want to show that admits a natural complex analytic space, and then the algebraic structure kind of follows from other considerations. Okay, so let me discuss concretely the some results, and let me start with the classical case, with the super classical case, the weight one case. And the model result that one would want is the Manfort-Namikawa type result. So one has the moduli space of curves, one has the Torelli map, and then that one extends nicely to the compactified versions. Here it's even better that I've talked before. You can go to the Voronoi compactification, a toroidal compactification, but of course when you do this one, you get also to the Satake-Bailey Borel compactification. I'm going slowly, so I don't want to dwell on it. What I want to, and I mean kind of whatever, so what I want to say is something slightly new. I mean, it's not that new in terms, I mean, it's from the last 5 or 6 years, but anyway, so this is something kind of less classical and that. So related to this picture, there are two questions that kind of naturally come up, and I mean they're important kind of also when you go to higher dimensions. So this is a curve case, a weight one case. So the two questions that I want to briefly address here is, let's assume that I'm changing my compactification. So for curves, we have this super good compactification, the Delin-Manfort, the Delin-Manfort compactification. But why not we can change the compactification for the moduli of curves? And kind of closely related, what about other moduli spaces such that the period map again gives you a variation of whole structure of weight one? So this was, the Hassett-Kill program was something very active a couple of years ago. Now seems to not much activity recently, but in any case, it doesn't matter so much about the details, but this is, for instance, one way how you get alternative compactifications to the moduli space of curves. So the idea here is that you can view that the Delin-Manfort compactification is a log canonical compactification. And then you can generalize this by introducing a coefficient alpha, kind of a generalized log canonical model. And corresponds to alpha equals one. And as alpha goes to zero, you allow worse and worse singularity. The first thing that you'll get is these pseudo stable curves for alpha equals 9.11, and you allow cusps, but you disallow elliptic tails, and this is a very nice moduli space. In an alternative way, this would be your preferred compactification for the moduli of curves. So nothing wrong with it. And in fact, you get a bunch of them. There is a complicated story about birational transformations, relations, and stuff like that. What I did with Casalina and Martin, with Fiano, was to try to reverse the process. So we are starting, suppose that we landed on a different planet and they have their favorite moduli compactifications for the moduli of curves. And we want to get back to MG bar or to, from the perspective of this talk, rather to AG. But here is more or less in the case of curves is equivalent. So basically I'm taking a local moduli space. So this is just a deformation of a curve, like a singular curve in my moduli. And my question is, how do I resolve the map from B to the moduli space of curves, or if you want, to the moduli space of AG star? Remember that what we are doing here is to consider a geometric compactification and try to compare with Bailey-Borel type compactification. So here, B is kind of like the geometric compactification, and then we want to resolve this map. In the case of curves, a Borel type extension results hold. This was written by De Jong and Ward. And basically, theoretically, you can always get a nice answer, provided that you take a log resolution of the discriminant. So here you have the deformation space for a singular curve. There you'll have the discriminant. And if you blow up the discriminant to normal crossings, then you get a map to MG bar without kind of any geometry and that. So this is secretly what you are doing here. Is, I guess, what Dan was doing kind of much more general, and that is some sort of simultaneous semi-stable reduction for curves. In general, you have this De Jong Ward theorem telling you how to do it. You need to put the discriminant in log resolution and so on. What I did with Fiano, we realized that in the case of AD curve, this is a very nice example. So I'm taking curves that they have AD singularity. So The first one would be node, where nothing, you don't need to do anything. Then cast tag nodes, this would be the ANKs, then there are the DNKs and so on. And these pictures, it seems to me, is very similar to what Dan was doing, and I cannot explain all the logs move and that, but basically, so you start here, this is a starting point. So you have the deformation space of a curve with AD singularities. This would be basically a product of the deformation of the local deformation spaces times a smooth slice corresponding to deforming the normalization. That doesn't really matter. Then you take a vial cover corresponding. So this is why it's important to have the AD singularities, because you take the vial cover, the vial group associated, and there is a natural thing. And what happens when you do this one, the original discriminant, so this is a discriminant, here becomes arrangement of hyperplanes. Now when you have an arrangement of hyperplanes, then it's easy to produce a normal crossing. So you just do the naive blow up of linear strata. So this is a normal crossing discriminant. And by their own word, this one actually maps to MG bar. Radu, in fact, yes.
So about the hyperplane, this is a result of Arnold, right?
Yeah. So this is Briscorn Arnold. So what I mean, and this is completely analogous to the surface with AD singularity. So later on, I'll come back to the surface case. In the surface case, the point is that you only have finite monodromy. You only have finite monodromy, and in some sense, you don't need to do any blow up to resolve the map. But here, because the monodromy will have two components, and I mean, I cannot go too much into this if I want to say something about ice surfaces. So, I mean, the monodromy will have a semi-simple part, which is why you need to do this vial cover. And then there is a unipotent part, which kind of is the part that maps you to the boundary and stuff like that. So, but anyway, the point is that you do this complicated thing, and because this is kind of functorial, then this is equivariant, W equivariant, and the main point is that you go back to. So I guess this one is a modification. The final result is that you get a regular map from this B prime to MG bar, which is just a modification versus an alteration kind of at the level above. And of course, Dan told us that something like this can be done in full generality and whatnot. But here the point is that this is very, very explicit. And we actually have an application of this result, and this was why we did this one, which is kind of the second part, is what happens if you don't have curves. Say that you have this cubic free folds. I mean, people here probably know that cubic free folds are nothing but curves plus epsilon. So the probably one of the most famous results of Philip, among many others, is the fact that a cubic threefold is not rational. And the proof uses a Torelli map. So to a cubic threefold, you associate the intermediate Jacobian, basically the Hodge structure on the middle cohomology, which fortunately is like a curve type. And what we started this one, I don't know, 15 years ago, I don't know, I'm getting old. Anyway, so we wanted to compactify this one. So basically we wanted to compactify here, and the goal was to understand kind of the possible degenerations of intermediate Jacobians. I mean, for instance, this is related to the hyperkeler compactification, my work with Claire and Claire Voisin and Julia Sacca, but let me not get into that direction. So basically, we want to understand what are the possible degenerations of intermediate Jacobians. So the natural thing to do is to compactify both sides and see what's happened. You have a cheap compactification, which, I mean, we are talking about hypersurfaces. So the so what we are doing here is to consider the GIT compactification. And what happens is this is due to Alcock. So there is a very nice compactification, the GIT, and you this is described in terms of singularities. And the really good thing is that most of them, there is one case that needs to be separate. These are IDE type. And kind of like the previous theory that I said about kind of simultaneous semi-stable reduction applies in this situation. And the first results of this was maybe 2007 or something like this, long time ago, was to obtain a normal crossing resolution by doing this wonderful blow up using the vial cover and all of that to obtain a normal crossing compactification for the moduli of cubic cubic threefold. I mean, the point here is that this one will map to the Satake-Bailey-Borel by Borel extension. And one thing to mention in this story is that when I say normal crossing compactification is always in the stack sense. So locally, after passing to a finite cover, one gets a normal crossing compactification. For extension results, this kind of suffices. And then we've upgraded this result, I don't know, 10 years later or something of that magnitude. We have upgraded to kind of like the analog of Namikawa-Mumford theorem, namely this normal crossing compactification actually maps to the Voronoi. And I mean, this is nice because, I mean, now you associate to a degeneration of cubics, you actually associate, I mean, the Satake-Bailey-Borel doesn't have modular meaning. In contrast, the Voronoi has. So in some sense, you can say that you've managed to obtain kind of a family of semi-abelian varieties for all cubics and their degenerations. And briefly, I mean, the idea is very, very closely related to what I've been talking about curves, in the sense that here we are doing, I mean, the thing to know is what Mumford observed, kind of Mumford take on Clemens Griffiths, was that the intermediate Jacobian is the prime of a plane quintic. And then one can do the same thing, the simultaneous semi-stable reduction for primes. And the good thing, I mean, we are kind of lucky that we get this theorem. The theorem for primes is much more subtle, and there is no such analog for all primes and all of that. But it turns out that cubics avoid the Friedmann-Smith locus and whatever, and in the end, one gets this theorem. I mean, the point of the point here, I mean, all I wanted to exemplify in this thing is, number one, one needs normal crossing compactifications of the moduli. And number two, and even kind of this unipotent monodromy. I mean, the unipotent monodromy always comes up when you pass to kind of this stacky cover that's always in this picture. So you actually need the unipotent monodromy in the type of arguments. And then if everything works fine, then you will get the extension to the other side, and then you can go from there. Now let's switch the dimension. And I mean, I should say kind of an important thing in this business is that, of course, as the weight increases, the situation is more difficult, but also there is some sort of periodicity mode too. So weight one is similar to weight three. Weight two is similar to weight four for many reasons. And there is another kind of case that I have some work and some work in progress about Calabi-Yau free falls, which behaves much more like curves versus surfaces. But anyway, okay. So in weight two, at least if we talk about surfaces of general type, we have a good geometric compactification, the Kolar-Shepard-Baron-Alexeyev compactification that is analog of MG bar. And here there is a nice clean classification of KSBA's varieties. You basically allow the higher dimensional analog of the nodes and require that the dualizing sheaf is ample and so on. But there is some bad news. Basically, the SLC singularities are quite complicated and quite varied, and the boundary of the moduli is far from normal crossings. And I don't know if you leave my talk now or something like this. Let me just say, actually in dimension two, this is not so bad. I mean, what do I mean by this? Of course, we know that Vakil-Smurfy's law, everything can go wrong and whatever. But from the perspective of what I'm doing here, if you choose a good moduli space and so on, from the perspective of comparing the geometric compactification, which here is this KSBA compactification with some Hoche-theoretic compactifications, then we are in relatively good shape. So I think this is a take. Okay, and the starting point of my project with Philip, Colin, and Mark was we wanted to use Hoche theory to understand the KSBA compactification for some surfaces, some fixed class of surfaces with small invariants. So our approach is to look at the KSBA via Hoche theory and the D-mod gamma. And I think we'll have some talks later in the week. This particular case, the ice surfaces, was studied intensely from a geometric perspective from FPR. So our perspective is that we are using what FPR but our perspective is that in some sense we are refining their classification and kind of organizing. And the main conjecture, we've made some progress, but I mean there is still work to be done, is this one. So I mean this would be for ice surfaces, but presumably for more classes of surfaces of general type. So this part is kind of the known part. So we have a KSBA compactification. We have, let's assume, a good period map like Torelli Holtz, let's say. And then what we want is, first of all, we would want to have a Bailey-Borel type compactification. And second of all, we would like to have some regular map extending this. So one, there is a lot of progress. Two, on the face of it, seems hopeless. I mean, as I said, and I mean the point of my discussion for curves was that you need to do semi-stable reduction and you need to go to normal crossing discriminants and whatnot. If you try to do that for surfaces, you'll get nowhere. I mean, even the simplest type of singularities and that. So let me explain why this has a chance to work out, and I mean kind of some evidence towards that. First of all, the first remark to do is that one has the Grothendieck Briscoe simultaneous resolution, And basically, if you have a family of surfaces with ADE singularities, if you do the while-based change, you kill the monodromy, and then you can do a semi-stable. You can resolve simultaneously the singularities. So from the perspective of moduli spaces, you can consider not only the smooth surfaces, the ADE surfaces. So this is good because, as you saw, in order to resolve for curves and the same story for higher dimension like threefolds and so on, in order to resolve the period map for, say, a Calabi-Yau threefold with ADE singularities, automatically you'll need to blow up the discriminant to normal crossings. At least in even dimension, this is not the case because the monodromy is finite and it suffices a wild cover. And then you can forget about the wild cover if you just care about the extension of the period map. If you care about the family, you need to take the wild cover. But if you just care about the map from the moduli to D mod gamma, then this can be ADE surfaces. Okay. Now the question is why would you have such a map? I mean, it's hard to explain why you would have such a map kind of in general, since we don't really know the existence of this ZBB. So let me focus on the case where we understand the existence of the Bailey-Borel compactification and where everything is fine. So let's focus on the K-free surfaces. So here, the good thing is that the period domain, so this is classical case. This is Bailey-Borel exists. Of course, the downside here is that for K-free surfaces, they are K-trivial. You don't have a KSBA compactification, but maybe you can get around it. Maybe you can work with pairs. I try to do this, and I think Valerie has much more to say in that direction later today. Maybe you can work with a good moduli, some sort of Artin stack, and so on. Concretely, I have something to say in the low degree cases. So basically, in the low degree cases, you don't have the KSBA compactification, but you have a substitute, which is a GAT compactification. And when you work with these things, you'll notice the following. So the GAT compactification is pretty bad. And I mean, what's happening is that you always end up with some bad singularities kind of in the, I mean, there are two things about the GAT. First of all, it's not modular in the strict sense, it's only modular in the sense of good moduli F alpha and so on. So this is like an Artin stack at the boundary, but still you have some weak geometric meaning there. And second of all, the GAT tends to introduce some bad things. So for instance, in the case of degree 2K free surfaces, this corresponds to double cover of the plane branch in a sextic. Here in the GAT side, you'll see that you end up with something like triple conics, which are pretty bad. And those are kind of some sort of analog of hyperelliptic curves. So if you do GIT for one embedded curves, you'll end up with freeborn curves, with kind of non-reduced curves and stuff like that. But at least in the low degree cases, we know how to take care of this. So in the degree two is particularly easy. You just blow up this point corresponding to the triple conic, then you get something much better, which turns out to be also semi-toric compactification. And from the point of view of what I want to say today, is that you are getting a moduli space. I mean, kind of this is kind of a good moduli space in the sense of alpha, good moduli. I mean, it's not a Delin-Mumford stack, so this is in the sense of alpha. such that all the points parameterized by this correspond to SLC singularities. And from my perspective, so this is number one that's important and why I put this one here kind of. And the second thing is the existence of this map from the SLC compactification to the Bailey-Borel. So this is the Bailey-Borel, which here exists and that. A similar picture holds in degree 4 and 6. Here the picture is much more complicated. So here you'll not be, I mean, there are many more singularities showing up and you'll need to blow up and do a bunch of flips starting from the GAT. But at the end of the day, again, you get to the SLC compactification, which maps to the Bailey-Borel compactification. And here, I don't know, maybe I'm ignorant about the subject. Here is a huge gap in the moduli theory. So people, I mean, Kollar, Shepard, Baron, of course, they looked on the general type picture, and you have a very nice picture from the perspective of the existence of a good compactification. On the other hand, for Fano varieties, kind of the opposite of general type, nowadays you have this K moduli compactification coming from that. And I think the K trivial case, so basically like the K trivial case, is a combination both kind of KSBA and K moduli. And what I believe is that there exists some sort of good moduli parametrizing degenerations of K3s, or more generally Calabi-Yaus with SLC singularities. And this moduli space, furthermore, so this is part one of my conjecture. I mean, part one is to set up like functorial or something, that part. And the second part is furthermore, and this is what's interesting for me, furthermore, this SLC compactification is in fact a Luyhenga type compactification of the moduli of K3s. Okay.
Radu, yeah. May I just say one word?
Yes.
I think I will give a solution to this conjecture.
Okay. So I mean that's great news. And anyway, so let me just Anyway, the point, I mean, from my perspective and kind of like the what I want and what was the important part for me is why this kind of SLC and why we don't need to do any kind of this alteration. So what I'm trying to say here in the earlier conjecture, I cannot go back so easily to my slides. So the conjecture is that I have a compactification with SLC singularities. I'm thinking towards kind of the project with Philip et al. So we are looking at general typing in particular. So the claim is that you have a good period map without the need to do alterations to the base. I don't know if that is true or not, but I'm giving some evidence that this is plausible. So basically, if you have a one parameter degeneration, you have two different things. On one hand, you have the Lins mixed-Hodge structure, which is associated to the central fiber, to the singular variety. On the other hand, you have the limit mixed-Hodge structure, which comes from Hodge theory, which doesn't care about the central fiber. It cares only about the family. And there is a specialization map between those two. So it goes from the cohomology of X0 to the limit. But this is kind of in general pretty weak information. I mean, this map, for all we know, it can be zero or something like this. And the theorem, is that if the central fiber has SLC singularity, then the specialization map is an isomorphism on the frontier Hodge diamond. And I mean, here I should note, my work with Matt Kerr, so we do kind of more general results, but I mean they are relevant in dimension greater equal than 3. So here this is kind of the best you can do in dimension 2. So from this perspective, let me not get in that direction. So what do I mean is you have the Hodge diamond and you see that because you have a compact projective variety, basically above a certain level is zero, while the limit Hodge structure is kind of symmetric about the monodromy acts and you have a symmetry of the Hodge diamond. So the specialization map can never be an isomorphism. But what I said there is kind of the lower half yellow piece is preserved. And this follows, the baby version, and this is why K3s are so important. The baby version was due to Mumford and Shah wrote this, and my understanding is that he was influenced by some results of Mumford and so on in the 80s. Then in mid 80s, Stenbring kind of interpreted the results of Shah as saying that Dubois singularities are cohomologically insignificant. So cohomologically insignificant means exactly that you preserve the frontier Hodge diamonds. And finally, Kolar Kovac, I mean, I guess 5-6 years ago, or now maybe 10, they proved that any SLC singularity is Dubois. So when you put everything together, you get the very nice thing is that if you, for KSBA compactifications, you preserve the frontier Hodge diamond. So what it means is that for KSBA compactifications, you read pieces of the limit mixed Hodge structure kind of from the central fiber. And the lucky situation in dimension 2, I guess also dimension 1 would be the same thing. In dimension 2 is that the only HPQ part, I mean, the only part that's not covered. So, I mean, in dimension 2, you just have kind of H11 here. H11 here. So those are the ones not covered. I mean, plus keeping in mind that the specialization morphism is a morphism of mixed Hodge structure and so on. Basically, only the algebraic part might differ, which is something to expect in the sense that the KSBA compactification, you get something like even the total space might be singular. So when you resolve that, you might introduce some algebraic classes that might be a difference between the limit Hodge structure and the singular Hodge structure, the Linz mixed Hodge structure. But in any case, you determine the monodromy type and the graded pieces of the limit mixed Hodge structure. So in particular, you can read off finite monodromy is equivalent to saying, so if you look at H2 and you look in weight 2, the finite monodromy is equivalent, and assuming semi-low-canonical and all of that, you get this is equivalent to the Hodge structure of the central fiber is pure. And also you can read off the graded pieces of the limit mixed Hodge structure. So in some sense, I mean, you read kind of, I mean, what you don't read, and I mean, that's important and maybe Mark Green will give some example, or there will be some discussion. What you need here are the extension classes, and I mean that's an entire talk that one can give about this. But so this led us to the conjecture. So let me just see where is the conjecture. So the conjecture is that you have a regular map from the KSBA compactification to a Bailey-Borel type compactification. So this map is kind of well defined, at least set theoretically. And, I mean, I guess the first thing to worry about is to solve one, but still. Okay, and I have 5 minutes or maybe 8 minutes. So let me say something about ice surfaces. So as I said, ideally, we would have number one, this part here, number two, that part there. And I mean, everything is kind of work in progress there. But the good thing here is that you don't really need to have the full picture. I mean, this is more like a motivational picture and all of that. So you don't need to fully prove one and two to get something useful. So basically, our idea, or kind of like, provided that we don't have the ideal situation, or we don't know yet how to show it, to prove it, we can focus instead stratum by stratum. So remember that I said that SLC singularities, if I know x0, so x0 determines, so maybe H2 of X0 determines the graded pieces of the H2 limb. I'm always confused about the weight and that. So this means that I can say I'm looking at surfaces with this type of Hodge structure, and this defines a well-defined stratification on this KSBA strata. And in fact, there are two types of strata, kind of from the Hodge theory perspective. One is the boundary strata, meaning what it means. So I'm looking at some sort of compactification of the period domain, or rather here, this would be some sort of my Z. Or if I, even in the interior, I have a natural stratification, this Noether-Lefschetz type stratification, which is very important. I'll call them this stratification kind of Manfort-8 stratification. And you'll see why do I care about both in a minute. So basically, I can take like a Hodge theoretic stratum, and I can try to understand the geometric stratum in the KSBA and period map. So about the boundary strata, there is earlier work by Colleen, some of it with Matt Kerr and Greg Pershtin and maybe others, where they studied a lot kind of from the abstract perspective, the Hodge theoretic strata, and they have very nice results, some sort of surprising results in terms of the incidence of Hodge theoretic strata, and there is an entire theory. I mean, in the PG equals 2 case, the situation is fairly easy. There are basically 5 types of boundary strata. Somewhere in my previous notes, but I skipped in the K3 situation, there are 2 types of boundary strata, type 2 stratum and type 3 stratum. And this is kind of the natural next thing. You start with PG equals 2, and you have, this would be kind of the type of thing that you are getting. So this is the smooth case, and then you start, these are the lower part of the limit mix Hodge structure. And it's pretty obvious kind of what are the possibilities. And the idea would be to compare the moduli. So this is in the KSBA For instance, here you restrict to surfaces with, say, E7 tilde. This is my example. And on the other hand, you restrict to the space, to the Hoche theoretic space, classifying space for Hoche structures of given type. I mean, here what I'm talking on the Hoche theory side is fairly easy because I'm forgetting about the complications. I'm forgetting about, I'm looking only at the graded pieces. And I mean, what is nice if you take a look at this diagram here, what an expert will notice immediately is that in the situation that I am, in the PG equals two situation, all the Hoche theoretical boundary strata are in fact of classical type. So for instance, if I look at the simplest type of degeneration, so I drop PG by one, so you'll see that I'm looking at the graded pieces. So there will be really two pieces, one which is K-free type, the other one which is elliptic curve. So the classifying space here would be just a product of two classical domains. So on one hand, the period domain for K-frees, and on the other hand, the Siegel upper half space corresponding to the weight one piece. So this is that, and the other is there. And concretely, one has this, I mean, I think the notation is N2 notation in FPR. So I'm considering the I surfaces. There I have an irreducible stratum corresponding to I surfaces with a single E7 tilde singularity. And it turns out that this has a natural period map. So this is the period map on the boundary to something like D mod gamma prime times the Siegel upper half space times some modular group. And concretely, one can understand this situation very well, because such a surface like an I surface with E7 tilde, I mean, there is a bit of geometry going on. You see that is birational. Such a surface is birational to a pair consisting of a degree 2K free surface together with a hyperplane section with which is nodal. So you have a hyperplane section which is nodal. So the hyperplane section has arithmetic genus 2 because we are degree 2. So the normalization will actually be an elliptic curve. So basically the period map simply forgets the K-free surface. I mean, simply associate the K-free surface and the elliptic curve. And this is as nice as it gets. So basically in this situation, what we have, this is a KSBA stratum. This is MKSBA. This is a part of the boundary will map dominantly and finite to one actually to this product of classical domains. And now, of course, the good thing is that this being classical, you have Bailey-Borel, and you can understand how these things close up and all of that. I mean, concretely, this is basically geometrically just a plane sextic together with a tangent line. So you see that you are getting residually, you get 4 points in P1 that gives you the elliptic curve, and you have the sextic, which gives you the K-free. So the upshot is that by this method, I mean, there are two things. So on one hand, we stratify the KSBA compactification kind of based on Hoche theory. And the second thing is that we get a pretty good hold of each stratum individually. Hopefully one day we'll have the full kind of extension from KSBA to Bailey-Borel. And I mean, that should give a pretty good understanding of the moduli picture for ice surfaces and so on. There is a big downside, at least so far, is that we don't know what exactly to do with kind of the non-Gorenstein case. So when you go, I mean, for K3s, and one thing that I have some papers on K3s and so on. One thing that one sees nicely is that the degenerations have to be Gorenstein if you do the usual thing. But when you go to higher PG, automatically you'll get into this wall singularities type, and controlling the index of the singularity is very hard, and I think there is some progress that maybe some of the FPR or Julie Rana will report later in the week. But in any case, so in the Gorenstein case, you are very you are in a very nice situation. You have the ice surfaces are weighted hypersurfaces in a projective space, and I think you get a complete understanding both geometrically and the stratum by stratum, the connection to Hoche theory. From our perspective in the non-Gorenstein case, what's happening is that you get these KLT singularities that don't KLT but not canonical, that lead to finite monodromy. So what it means is that the limit mixed Hoche structure will be automatically inside E mod gamma. So Hoche theoretically, from the perspective of monodromy, you'll not detect them. Even worse, and I mean, this was the original paper of Wall or maybe Friedman-Morgan and so on. Even worse, there are some examples of quotient singularities where there is no monodromy at all. So basically you have a degeneration that has singularities, but the monodromy is trivial. And what I hope, and I mean, this is based on no evidence, is that you can still detect this strata of, so basically here, let me draw a picture. So you have a moduli space and you have this, for instance, this is a divisor with singular corresponding to surfaces with one quarter, one singularities. And my hope is that while you cannot detect them in terms of monodromy, you can still detect them by more refined Hoche tensors, by this kind of Manfort 8 strata. I mean, the only evidence that I have to this is kind of the counter positive to this one, meaning that if this were not true, it would mean that you have this kind of entire divisor in the moduli space, which is kind of correspond to singular surfaces, but kind of the Hoche structure associated to them is, you cannot distinguish it from a general ice surface. So it's kind of like general Hoche theoretical. This doesn't quite happen in practice, but I mean, who knows? So that's basically where I want to end up. And I think I'm actually over time. Apologies.
Okay, thank you, Radu, for a very nice talk. And we have time for questions or comments.
Yeah. To what extent? So you can I ask a question?
Can you hear me? Yes, go ahead. Yeah.
So you mentioned part of the issue, not throughout the talk, but even when things are of a classical type, you have a Bailey-Borel compactification, but you don't have a modular meaning to the Bailey-Borel compactification.
Yes, I mean that one. I mean, I have a picture. I was just sorry, to say how small is the Bailey-Borel. So in the K3 situation, the Bailey-Borel is one dimensional. So here there are, I mean, this is a concrete example. So there are four curves meeting in one point. This is the Bailey-Borel compactification. So in some sense, the Bailey-Borel reflects very little information
from the logarithmic geometry point of view. So the toroidal compactifications are all logarithmic. So you each decomposition gives you a log smooth sort of family.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so what you're searching is something that some sort of logarithmic modelized space which knows about log smooth structures up to subdivisions. And that actually exists in some sense. So I wonder if you are aware of there's work of Molcho and Wise that basically starts in that direction. So so there is a modular meaning to the Bailey-Borel in the sense that there is a notion of logarithmic modulized space.
Mm-hmm.
Whose best geometric approximation is the Bailey-Borel, just like good modelized space is best geometric approximation, or GIT quotient is best.
I mean, rather maybe would be something like this. This sigma part F2 sigma or something, so slightly. I mean, I have to do kind of a slight subdivision in the Bailey-Borel to, I think so. So maybe that, because Luijenga is really, really almost like the Bailey-Borel. So I guess that would be a kind of a general answer. I mean, the issue, the issue is rather kind of like the existence of this Bailey-Borel on one hand, kind of in general, I mean, and the existence of the map to the Bailey-Borel, which might actually, I mean, there is something that I haven't talked about at all. There is also this, the Hodge bundle and some consideration with the Hodge bundle, which actually might show the existence of the map, kind of the global versions.
I guess my point is that if you use that logarithmic, once you have a logarithmic modular meaning, you will have a way of constructing the map. Because whenever you have a modular meaning.
I see, okay. Maybe you can send me the, I mean, I was vaguely aware of this, but a precise reference would be great. So maybe then, you can send.
Then?
Yes, Valerie.
I guess the question is, when you give this modular definition, do you input the fan in the definition? Because if you do, then it's kind of a tautology. You know, you haven't done anything. So if you don't input the fan,
no, the point is
part of your definition.
No, then was looking at the Bailey-Borel where you take some sort of.
Yeah, so you are taking
like 4K3 surfaces. Maybe you just remember the elliptic curve on the boundary. That's the Bailey-Borel data. So that's remembering very little, and you can say that's some kind of modular meaning, but extremely small.
Yeah, so the issue is precisely that Bailey-Borel itself is not the modelized space. It's like the good moduli of something that is a modelized space.
Yeah.
Okay, so there is a canonical map from something that is modular to the Bailey-Borel.
I mean, one trivial kind of answer is you look at all Kulikov surfaces, you know, there are infinitely many types, etc., of type 2. But for each such surface, you only remember the J invariant of the elliptic curve. Yeah, this is kind of a huge moduli space, but if you only remember the J invariant, then that's a map to Bailey-Borel.
So I have no answer in a concrete answer in this concrete case, but I would suggest looking at at what Molko and Weiss do.
Thank you. Other questions or comments?
When you give your conjecture star, do you expect it? So the KSPA compactification has these extra components which only contain singular surfaces. Do you expect
here, of course, I'm restricting to like the main components. And also presumably there is a lot of normalization going on kind of like some sort of normalization of the KSBA compact, of the main component of the KSBA compactification, stuff of that nature. So of course you can focus also on the other components, but those will lend. What we know so far is to look kind of stratum by stratum.
If say the general surface in one component has one of these wall singularities, then it would land in the main component of the mm-hmm. Hodge, of the period domain, right?
I guess so, yes.
Okay, anyway.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Radu, there was, I think, some other questions that appeared, if you want to respond to those.
So I see a question about the compactification. We have in our paper, that's the revised 2020 revision of our earlier GGLR. So basically we construct, I think, as a topological space. First of all, where do I have it? This Z Bailey-Borel corresponds to a given Z. So you cannot hope to compactify the entire period domain. And I should say that here, this is much bigger dimensional and there is a lot of transcendence going on. So you just look at the image of the period map. So this is kind of the magic of the situation. And now this is a fact, this BBT paper and so on. So you look at something quite transcendental and bad in general, but when you restrict to an image of a period map, that becomes quasi-projective, and then you can hope to compactify it by adding these pieces corresponding to the graded pieces of the limit mixed-Hodge structure. So you know the pieces. So now we constructed in our paper, we constructed something that's topological, but if we were to know that this has a natural complex analytic structure, then we would get like a projective compactification and that. One interesting example would be, maybe this is a good question for a student or something, is even the case PG equals one, if you look at general type surfaces, because there you would have both the KSBA compactification and this Bailey-Borel compactification. And the hope there would be that you are getting either a toroidal compactification or some sort of Luyhenga semitoric compactification, which would the Bailey-Borel, in the PG equals one, as Valery said, is kind of dumb. You just remember a point and then the elliptic curve, but it might be that you remember also partial extension data, which would correspond to a semitoric compactification. So.
If there are no other questions, then thank you again, Radu. And the next talk is 1:30 Eastern Time, U.S., by Alexeyev. And So we will reconvene then.